him as well.
He is Lord, Lord of all, God of all.
Oh my God, never in your life did I get, please.
Oh,
hey.
Hey. Oh my God. She's in it.
Great way. Yeah.
It's even time to stop, my girl.
They might be Christian now
because they remembered, like,
my mom used to say that every time they'll come to school, they'll tell, she keeps on me talking about
Jesus.
It's a key too high.
Your range
of hi, camera.
Yeah. Thank you.
Ashley was touching you to shut up, by the way.
Mercy.
Mercy, the
unveil the beauty that silence brings.
Yeah, Angela.
Oh, yeah, do that.
I'm sorry, man. I'm
funny. Patience wasn't afraid of a spirit.
Hey!
Hi, guys.
Hi.
If they fall and drop my hat, my
just,
like, Okay, sorry. Stop that. I'm so confused. You want to go to the floor?
No, that's actually what creatives unite.
Hi guys,
welcome to the first episode of Creatives Unite. I'm here with some lovely ladies who are going to be talking about themselves, essentially, and they're going to introduce themselves very soon. But essentially, what Creatives Unite is, it's just a space for people to come together and talk about the things that they do and how they do it so excellently and achieve it whilst being at university. And I just want to expose the excellence that is in Warwick outside to the real world. So, ladies.
Hello.
If you would even introduce yourself, let's start from Toyosi.
Hi guys, my name is Toyosi Somoye.
Hey.
Yeah. What do you currently do?
What do I currently do? I just finished at Warwick. Graduated.
Wow.
Yeah, thank God. I have a charity organization in Nigeria, currently on the hold, but do different outreach projects. Do a bit of public speaking, to the TEDx recently.
Yeah,
I do a bit of events and write a bit of poetry.
So good.
Maybe you can publish soon.
Hi guys, I'm Angela. You guys just know me so much, I don't want to take up this time, but content creator, stylist, graduate. Let's even
Hi guys, I'm Anu. I am a worshiper. I do makeup, so I'm a makeup artist. I also dabble in events regarding female well-being. I have a blog where I write poetry and just things God is teaching me. and I'm also a content creator.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah. Hey guys, my name is Esther-Tofi, and I am a recent graduate. I have a podcast. Mm-hmm. I have a community interest company that has a few different branches to do with homelessness and some other things that will come later. Mm-hmm. I do events, I do public speaking, and yeah, that's really a bit of me, you know?
Hi guys, I'm Essie. I am 22, still currently studying my master's in innovation and entrepreneurship, and I'm very passionate about community building. So currently I'm run a platform called Orphans Christian, and in that we do events. We literally just plug people with resources, and the heart of everything we do is just to unite souls to Christ, one resource at a time.
Good, yeah, no, we love that, even biblical.
Thank
you, Mercy. So essentially, if you guys don't know, you could probably see by the screen, these are called the Multifaceted IT Girls, because if you guys don't know, these are the faces of Warwick campus. You see, when people come to Warwick, they
That does not happen.
People are in awe to see these girlies in the flesh. So I just hope you guys know the grace that I have in my house today, currently. So yeah, we're gonna go into an icebreaker, so it's a bit fun and fresh just to get us going before the question. So based on High School Musical, actually, so you guys know the main characters, right? We're gonna focus on the girls. So we have Sharpay, Gabrielle, Taylor. Is Taylor right?
Who was Taylor? The basketball girl, Kelsey, she's the fourth one. So yeah, Sharpay, Gabrielle, Taylor, and Kelsey.
We're gonna discuss who out of us we think represents those people, and there's five of us, so you can say more than one for each person.
Okay, this is good.
I think I'm Gabrielle, I'm not a Sharpay. Everyone would just, I think, so you'll see is a Kelsey. Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, what is it, just, I don't know, there's an issue. What is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of a, what is Kelsey doing? Why, she's a bit of
You are Sharpay. Oh. Yeah.
I think Marcy's Mercy.
Me?
Yeah.
Sorry, explain.
I hear it.
Because she's just nice.
She kind of brings
things together in a sense. Yeah, she kind of brings a form of
The show wouldn't have happened without her.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Cause did you hear that? I bring people together.
Yeah. So I think.
What's the basketball guy's girlfriend?
I'm Taylor.
How did you get there? Troy, she's like, don't let me go.
Yeah.
That's why I think on the bridge.
That's why I think Ify's Gabrielle, because like she's very like movie-esque.
Okay,
like,
I hear you.
Romantic-esque kind of.
What's that song on the bridge?
I've got to move.
I've got to. I hope you understand.
No, I find my way. She's like, right now, for now,
I gotta go my own way.
She said, don't let me go. She didn't say funny. They're still doing it passionately.
Oh, she don't let me go. It's like, what about us? What about everything? No.
Like, no, I'm not her.
She's Sharpay. So why did you do all of that?
No, because I just had
because she's Sharpay. No, Sharpay, Kelsey.
But the thing is, I don't think I'm a Taylor.
I thought you were like a Gabrielle.
But I feel like, okay,
I hear that.
Yeah, I can see you in Troy, and they're gonna go, no, I can see it. I think you're Gabrielle.
I do feel that.
Do you know what? Let's skip Taylor. She's a lovely babe, but you know.
I just don't think anything
about her. We've got two Sharpays, two Gabrielles, and one Cassie.
We don't have two Sharpays. She has one Sharpay.
Do you know what? It's a mutual agreement, so we're gonna have to go with
it. There can only be one.
It's final,
but that was actually great. I think we really, you know.
Yeah.
Interacted.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So, moving on to the question. So the first one is actually a quick fire question. So, what's your biggest achievement so far this year? You can only choose one.
Ooh. For me, it's the event that we did in the month of March, which was the Women Within. And I think it's literally just being able to see kind of a vision go from an idea all the way to execution, mm-hmm. and kind of moving out of the way and letting God do his thing. I think that for me was such a highlight moment, because it kind of symbolized where I was kind of shifting to as well, mm-hmm. and kind of where God was taking me. So it symbolized not just something for ATC, but something for me personally as well.
It's amazing.
I think that was great, by the way.
Thank you.
I think CCS taught me a lot.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Anything specifically
that it taught me?
Yeah.
You can't do it by yourself, man.
Yeah.
Hey guys, I can't remember. I was watching a video. You know that a vision is given by God when it takes more than you to like do it, to bring it to life. And I think sometimes we think, oh, I can do it by myself, I got this vision. But when truly God wants to bring something out of you, he calls you together, people together, and start to build, because you can't build by yourself. Like, even when he raised up people in the Bible, Moses had to have Aaron and Hur to lift his hands. And when he lifted his staff, the people, the Israelites were winning, and when he put them down, they were losing. But it's like, you have to have people around you to be able to even sustain a vision. But yeah, learned a lot.
I think I would have to say hands down the harvest. Just like Mercy, like the vision to execution was crazy. And I think something that Josiah said at Visionaries, one of them on the panel said something about like just seeing something coming from like, that came from nothing and turning into like something just so massive.
Yeah.
And something that was essentially out of myself. Like it just wasn't something I could ever really see myself ever doing. And I think coming to the end of the harvest and looking back and almost looking back on my last year and thinking, is this something that I would have ever imagined myself doing?
No. Yeah.
So I think it just goes to show the power that God has to kind of change somebody's story and bring them to a greater, almost a measure of success.
100%. That's really good. Okay.
Oh, this is a really hard question. This year I kept the requests keeping in my notes and I keep track of everything. And I was trying to think, and there's so many things that God has done this year. But I think the one that's most significant for me was my school inviting me, my secondary school inviting me to come back and speak at their second multicultural day, which I started in sixth form. And I think it was I was just so shocked, because when I started it back then, it was just because I was like, there's a lot of black people, but there's a lot of other people as well. They deserve to be celebrated. And to see like how passionate the school was in maintaining it, and then actually inviting me to come back and speak. And I remember once I finished this speech, they were just like, that was literally amazing. Like, you're somebody that genuinely inspires the students. Like, they were also happy to have you here. And they invited me back to speak like three more times this year. And it's just like,
to see how God would do that.
Like, because back in sixth form, like, I need Jesus for that. Like, it was just cool.
Yeah.
And
it's
like, looking at where I am with Jesus now and then having the opportunity to go back. It's like, oh, you were working way before I was in partnership with you the way we are now. So I think I would give it to that.
That's so good.
Yeah. I'd say, similar to these ladies, the Deep Medley and the Amor event. And I think the overarching theme is just obedience to God. Like, for God to say something or give a vision in seed form and then to see it manifest.
Yeah.
Especially when you can sometimes disqualify yourself and say events of a certain type of people or who have certain skills, but just to see that God really brought everything to life. It taught me how to depend on God as well. So I think that level of obedience and submission that I gained this year was the biggest achievement.
Yeah, what I just wanted to say is I find it so interesting how like everyone spoke about different things and I guess instances of public speaking or events, and it's so interesting how all of the things we did were bigger than us. Like, I was at some of the stuff, not all of them, but even like the feedback of people saying, oh, like, I was so inspired or I learned so much. It's like what you did didn't just like stay in that room or stay in that atmosphere, like it went further. I think there's a lot of times where we can do things just for ourselves and say, oh, that made me feel good. But it's like, yeah, it made you feel good, but what did it produce? And Jesus calls us to bear fruit.
Yeah.
So it's just so it's great so that all of you are bearing fruit and I get to be a part of this, you know, fruitful.
It's good.
Good.
Yeah.
You're bearing fruit too.
Amen.
Yeah.
I hope I pray. Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, thank you guys so much. So very quickly, earlier you guys mentioned what you're currently doing. So what do you think is your unique calling behind each role? Especially because you guys may not tie to yourselves just like one thing. So I want to know behind each role, what would you say is your unique calling?
Can I check my friend's answer really quickly?
Yeah.
So
I think for me, kind of the heart behind everything I do is an understanding of the love of God, and in that empowers me and kind of fuels me to love his people. So I always say I'm very much a people person, and someone tried to tell me isn't everyone, and I believe that everyone is called to people, but I think I'm uniquely called to people, and that kind of infiltrates into, I guess, different things that I would do. So for example, something God has caused me to fall in love with is truth, and in that it's inviting other people into truth. In that, something God has called me into is community building, so that is providing spaces for people and serving people. So I think it kind of infiltrates into different areas, but ultimately the overarching thing to answer your question, Angela, would be I'm called to people. And not just to love people, but to serve people and kind of everything I do from the foundation of the love of God.
I'm quite similar in the sense that, so I do content creation, I do styling, and then I've also had opportunities to speak, and then I've also helped hold events, an event. So it, for me, it's just kind of like all of that is surrounding community, and something that I've realized God has kind of, made a pattern in the last like maybe 6 months is just how each of them is a call to serve. And even one thing that I spoke about in one of my workshops at the Harvest was about the matters of the heart and how the importance of community comes into both styling and content creation, because essentially content, though it's your face, it's to serve people. You're literally like meant to serve your audience, your followers, whoever it is. With styling, you're styling somebody else. It's about the person, it's never about you. So in that way, they're both a form of service to other people. An event is all about the people. At the end of the day, you're serving the people that have all come. When you're speaking to inspire other people. So these are all things that I feel like God is kind of bringing together so that it's of service to people. And then obviously later on in the future, when it comes to building my own brand, at the end of the day, my clothes will be for people as well. So I think the overarching theme is community.
Through my projects and things that God calls me to do, it's to build bridges, because I think my experiences in life mean that I can like connect people who have similar experiences, and from feeling inadequate or feeling like I couldn't do certain things, I'm proving or God showing me that it's capable through me. I like to bring other people into that light, so that's why I say I identify as like a bridge builder. So a bridge builder from like a past self to a present self, and just take people on a journey. So every time I learn something new, I'm like, okay, how can I give that to other people? Because I realize it's not just for myself, it's for others around me. And then also, I believe I'm called to be like a catalyst for change in different spaces. So whether that is not fitting the status quo in the way that you create content or the way that you produce music, I think there's sometimes a set mold that people like to follow, but one thing that my sister always tells me is like, I know there are no rules, and Jesus reiterates that to me, I know there are no rules. So if you want to have a makeup artistry page that also focuses on holistic well-being, you can do it. Or if you want to get your friends together and record a live set at university, that people usually do when they're established or they have a certain amount of followers, you can do that, because you're meant to do things the way that God has inspired you to do it, rather than just fit in a specific mold. So I'd say those two words describe,
That's good. That's really good.
I think what I was going to say is, I think the overarching theme of what I do or what I try and do is, it's kind of similar to what people have said, but it's to see people. And I think things really change for you once you feel seen.
Yeah.
But the word "see" is actually an acronym. So God gave me the acronym, and it means, so S is for serve, E is for educate, and the other E is for empower.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, like, if I was to go into depth in that, we might be here for a long time. But just generally, it's like, I think there's a Bible script, there's a scripture that talks about how my people perish for lack of knowledge. And just like, I think so many things, like, when we walk through life not knowing, that's when we encounter a lot of obstacles. And generally, some people didn't even mean any harm, but just they fell into the wrong path because they didn't know.
Yeah.
And I think one of the things I even did last year, so I'm also going into finance, well, I'm in finance, and I was a campus ambassador for an investment bank. And it was even just like spreading the knowledge of how to get into the industry,
mm-hmm.
and what you need to get into it. And I think just in terms of so many areas, it's like, how can I give people knowledge? How can I empower people? Because I also teach sometimes and work with children. So it's like, how can I encourage you to be a better version of yourself,
mm-hmm.
because of what I know, what I've learned so far? But then I always say, like, I don't know everything, and I realize that. So how can I also continue learning,
mm-hmm.
to enable me to become generally more valuable to my community, whether it be if I'm in Nigeria, because I'm from Nigeria, or if I'm in London, or I go abroad, etc.
I think for me, the two main calls that or the mandates that God has given me, the first one is to redefine what it means to be a Christian, and the second one is to love. Redefining what it means to be a Christian. My podcast is called Redefine Gospel Sounds, and the point of the podcast is to show people Christ outside the church and the music industry. Because I remember when he was explaining it to me, it was very much like, people have put him in a box, and they, because of that box, they're unable to understand how he operates outside of their conventions and outside of their norms and traditions. So with that platform, we bring people in who aren't necessarily like gospel musicians or gospel stylists, but there are people who love Jesus, and they use the gifting that he's given them in their own capacity. With TUIC, like, everything that we do when it comes to homelessness, and it comes to community outreach, and it comes to events, everything we do is always from a neat angle. Like, he's so, God is literally ultimate creative, he's so unique. And I think with every event that I've done, it comes from a place of wanting to open people's eyes to see what it actually means to believe in Christ Jesus. And the second one I would say is to love, because I love love, and I love love so much because of God, because
yeah.
we love because he first loved us.
Yeah.
And I think part of me, like, one thing I do, which might happen again later, but I do a lot of counseling. And I think, similar to what Annie said about life experiences, because of the experiences I've had in my life, it ties in with the first point as well. Like, you just wouldn't expect me to be me. Like, people that come and speak to me, they often, like, come because it's like, oh, like, you're the only person I've seen that's spoken about this, or, like, the only person I know he's a Christian. Like, because I do a lot of things publicly when I'm serving God, but it's like, oh, she's doing that, but she also has this story. So I think in sharing God's love is showing his ability to love all of you,
yeah.
and how he is the author of your entire story. He didn't just join in when you began to meet him. He was orchestrating it from the very beginning.
Yeah.
And I think showing that love fuels almost absolutely everything I do in serving in any regard. Like, even worship,
yeah.
like, it's like, that's from a place of love. That's from a place of inviting people to understand Abba and understand his plan, understand his character. So I think, yeah, love and redefining what it means to be a Christian.
As you guys know, I've termed this the It Girls, and it kind of falls under the category of what we call a main character. And I know we joke around about this. I know we joke around about this term, but I've called you guys because I believe all of you fall in this category. I believe you guys are main characters. That is the truth. But do you guys think it takes you being a bit of a main character to succeed in some of your projects or industries? I've got a part two, which is, do you think it's possible to do this in full submission and humility to God?
I think I would have to start by defining what a main character is.
Yeah.
What do you guys think it is?
I think from a secular standpoint, a main character is somebody who's full of themselves, maybe, or like only cares about themselves and is ignorant to the world around them. But I think the way that you have depicted it to us is somebody who is
in tune with who God has called them to be,
yeah.
has a strong sense of identity,
yeah.
and pursues that vision and goal from that place. Yeah. So in that case, in order to succeed in our project, do I believe you need to be a main character? Yes.
Yes.
But I think that only comes from making Jesus the main character.
Yeah.
Because he's the author and the finisher of our faith. So that he gives us our identity.
That's so good.
Yeah.
That's
so good.
Yeah.
That's really good.
I agree with everything Annie said. And in addition to that, it kind of speaks into Godfidence, just kind of knowing whose you are and therefore from that place, kind of doing that which he's called you to do.
Yeah.
I would say I'm a main character because, yeah, I have an understanding of the God that I serve and I have an understanding of what he's asked of me.
Yeah.
So because he's spoken and asked of something for me, I must respond in a way that is pleasing to him. So I do everything because he desires for me to do that, or he asks of me to do that,
yeah.
That he may delight in what I do, if that makes sense.
No.
So yeah, I'm a character, and yeah, sometimes that extends out. Yeah. That I'm even showing a personality,
if we piggyback, we want to stop.
Can I even add on to it?
We will stop.
I promise you, we will stop.
Sorry, we'll stop. There's an end. What I was going to
say.
Mercy!
That is an end.
Oh! So Mercy was talking about Godfidence, and I think one thing that came up in my head was the word audacious and having the audacity to do some things.
Yeah.
And I remember actually looking back to my childhood, like just in general Nigeria, some people like to say, who gave you the audacity to do this?
Mm.
And I think a lot of times when you want to do big things or new things, it's like God gave you the audacity to do this, so go ahead and do it. And it's funny enough because even like CCS, well, for context, CCS Christian Christmas, an event that happened in Warwick earlier this year. Like, one thing about me, I really don't like reaching out to people. Like, I actually really just don't like it. But God said, yeah, you have to do it. Just not for just now, but also like generally in your future. So me personally, people say I speak a lot. I don't speak that much. I don't really like to speak. But God is literally pushing me out of my comfort zone to be more comfortable with speaking to new people, making new connections, and talking to people. And something I used to say a lot was that I'm shy, and God just said, like, who called you shy? Like, why are you calling yourself shy? And it's like, I think a lot of times we put labels on ourselves, or we let other people speak words over ourselves that become our identity.
Mm-hmm.
And God then says, for me to do through you what I always destined to do, you need to take off this label that I didn't even put on you myself.
Yeah.
And I think when we talk about main character, I think a lot of us are almost stripping off these labels and being like, I'm gonna do it. I actually don't care what other people say. And it's almost going to that childlike faith that things are gonna work out because, like, God said it's gonna work out.
Yeah.
So even if this specific project doesn't work out, don't worry, there's another one. There's more that God has in store for me, because it was never dependent on the project. It was dependent on God, the man who gave the word.
Yeah.
And if this doesn't work out, it's because he wanted you to learn something in that will be of benefit to you in the next season.
That's so good. Based off of Mercy's point as well, Jesus speaking says that if you want to be the greatest amongst people, you have to serve. And so the greatest is actually the person who goes lower than those around them. So in terms of being a main character in It Girl, all of us spoke about the theme of service, that everything that we do is to serve other people.
I'm going to say that I think the definition that we've given to the first part of the question quite beautifully answers the second part as to how you remain humble in being a main character.
Mm-hmm.
Because I would say that I'm a main character. I actually am. Like, I'm a main character person. But I think, like, one thing that my friends around me recognize is that I'm an incredibly humble person. And the reason that I am is because I acknowledge John 3 says it, that a man can receive nothing except to be given to him from above. And I remember, I think I told Angela this actually, or Mercy, like, when God said it, when I was reading it, and then God was saying to me, like, take this literally, like, you literally can't do anything outside of me.
Mm.
And I can be like, oh, but God, like, when I was sending this email, like, you weren't, like, giving me that. But he was, like, you can't do anything outside of God. And when you acknowledge that he is the source of everything, and the reason you're a main character, like has already been said, is because he's defined an identity for you, and he's molding you into this person. So as the ultimate creative,
there is nothing you can do outside of him. So it's like, the power doesn't come from me for me to not be humble, because we were talking about, like, if you don't pray one day, it's like, where did you get the confidence to not
to,
pray?
To not pray, like,
why do you feel that you can go a day without that?
Yeah.
I feel like that being plugged in, like, we're only main characters because we acknowledge him as sovereign. Like, if he wasn't sovereign, then I had to put him in character. Then I have an identity to hold on to.
I think, for me, what comes to mind is just approaching everything that I do from a place of childlikeness. Like, children, if you know them, are the biggest main characters ever, but they understand that they have parents, so they understand that they have a father. And I think I very much follow that same pattern where, absolutely main character, absolutely very, very childlike, which is great, but I understand that I have a father, God, who requires something of me, but also within the pattern of Jesus, actually, like, he was not outside, like, he never thought of himself more than other people. He never acted from a place where I'm the king of, like, he came as a suffering servant. And I think in that there's so much to learn about. Actually, that's my only framework of humility, if I'm going to be completely honest. Like, he is the only person I look to because he knew who he was. Like, yeah, he became sin for us. Like, he surrendered and submitted himself to the point of death, and that I can learn so much from that, because so much was also done through, like, we're living now out of an extension of what Jesus did on the cross, if that makes sense. And why that is, it kind of links to question two that was being asked, was just the fact that, like, yes, like, you can be a main character. Jesus is the main character of our lives. Like, he is literally the main character. Like, without Jesus, we're nothing, right? So he's literally, the consistent theme is he's the main character in each and every single one of our stories. Yet he was the most humble person, not was, he is the most humble person that we know. So if Jesus can do it, we can do it.
Once you accept the Holy Spirit into your life, you come to the realization that Jesus lives in you.
Good.
And I think even as much as you're saying that Jesus is the main character, if, like, if God lives in us, then we have the authority to also be the main character, because he's given us that authority. I think the danger comes when you think the exterior is better than the interior, and you don't, like, check yourself daily and check yourself constantly. Like, even as we say, like, die daily, it essentially means that, like, submit to Christ daily and realize it's not you doing it, but it's God doing it through you. And I think it's coming to a point where you're more and more conscious of that in your life.
Yeah, 100%. Just very quickly to add on to that, this morning I was reading 1 John 4, and it literally speaks directly into that. Greater is he who lives in us than he that is in the world. And it's just that understanding that in order for us to be main characters, because greater is he who lives inside of us.
We see with here is that the it girls, but the only thing that generally makes us it girls is that when we commune with the Father, we commune one-on-one. And I feel like when you don't consider yourself a main character, you commune with the Father in a way that's like, he doesn't care that much about you as an individual. We commune with the Father as if this is my dad. Like Mercy said, it was the childlikeness that you mentioned that made me want to say this. Like, the only reason with it girls is because we commune with an Abba Father. And when the word Abba literally means daddy, like, that is your dad. And we commune with him in such an on such an individual level. Like, he cares about my story. Like, oh my gosh, there was aunt in my sink the other day, and I was almost in tears. And I literally got anointing oil, and I prayed, and I was like, God, like, I'm not even saying this is a spiritual thing, but you know I hate insects. And this is how not come back to my house. Like, I believe that the Father cares so deeply and so intimately.
So much.
Like, so when you commune with him in that way, that's like every little thing throughout the day. But me and Matt said, like, what would Jesus see? Like, before we ask each other, like, oh, what's your opinion? What does my dad think?
What does Jesus
what does he? Because he cares. And I think it's something that we all do so well. Like, when Angela was saying the harvest, every little thing. What did Jesus think? What did Jesus think? And that's the only thing that makes us it girls, because we're main characters with the Father. Like,
good.
I'm your daughter and I know you care about me. And so we're talking about me, do you get it? But yeah, that's the only thing that makes us it girls. It's not like, not doing it, just Jesus.
So in light of the visionaries event, we've actually seen the excellence and dedication that it takes to execute a vision that God lays on your heart. So how do you guys keep multiple visions going ahead simultaneously and still remain within God's will for all of them?
This is such a good question. Literally learning it currently, as in when I say currently, as in yesterday. And I think, like, the simple kind of answer is focus. But it's genuinely that what God has shown you is a gift to be able to focus on more than one thing and steward, not even just focus, but to steward more than one thing at one time. And the grace in that comes from other people, like genuinely, like God has placed other people around you, not only people to help remind you, but people that would kind of serve that vision on your behalf. And something that God is teaching me right now with ATC, so literally our meeting on Saturday was all about delegating. As long as someone has an understanding of the vision and they have God that is within them, they're more than empowered to go ahead and do that. So I think one thing that I'm learning, so for me practically, what that kind of looks like is just literally delegating and trusting the God that is so alive within each person, and allowing them to kind of support you with those projects. Because it's like, with ATC, we have around 8 projects right now, but you probably only see one of them because I've kind of been limiting God in a sense where I've just been thinking about one thing at one time. But the way that God has kind of allowed us to pick things up over the past recent 3 days is literally just the ability to be able to delegate and have people who understand the vision and can execute from that place.
That's good. That's really good.
Yeah.
I think for me, I would say prayer, because when I started TUIC in 2020, God was like, God showed me so many things at once, like things that are 5 years from now, things that are happening. And like, I got in 2020 and it only literally happened last year. And I think knowing the timeline that the Lord wants you to operate on helps in knowing where your mind or what should be occupying space in your mind. I think delegation is incredibly important, but I think knowing like when something is meant to be birthed. So like this summer, for example, there's like 4 things that need to happen, and it's like, cool, I know this is the season for this. And like Mercy said, like knowing the people that God has put around you, understanding who has the heart for this vision, but in prayer it's like you know exactly what time and when to do it. So it's like, cool, this is meant to happen in August, this is going to happen in September, this is going to happen in July, and following that time means that nothing, like it's just like it just becomes so organized, because it's like, cool, you know exactly what you're focusing on and when. And I think when you remain in prayer, the Lord will remind you. So it's like, if there's something that you stopped stewarding so well, or there's something that you've forgotten, and God will remind me, he'll be like, oh, like, don't forget about this. And I'm just like, oh my gosh, like,
thank you.
Literally, I completely forgot about that. So I think when it comes to stewarding visions, because there's so much to do in life.
Yeah.
It's only 24 hours in a day. But I think, prayer and just allowing the Holy Spirit to be like literally the helper that he was sent to be.
But just very quickly, it's also understanding times and seasons, because I think if you have an understanding of times and seasons, you would understand what's required of you in that specific time. So you'll have some seasons where God will just kind of give you ideas that he wants you to just pray about, then he'll be like, now it's time for execution. So understanding when you're in a summer season, when you're in an autumn season, which is kind of like harvest, or when you're in a spring season, so that's just very much kind of enjoying those ideas, whatever it might be, just understand times and seasons.
That's important. That is definitely important.
Can I say a quote? I don't know, I'm not going to talk, but just a quote that I heard recently that I've been meditating on, and it just said that you can have everything but not at the same time, and I've just been meditating on that quite a bit recently.
I'd say write down the vision and make it plain. And I think there's, God's been highlighting to me recently the importance of writing down your visions in detail, so that you can plan ahead. So it's like you're not so stoppy and starty with things that God calls you to do, but it's like, I've planned already 3 months in advance by the grace of God through the place of prayer, where I've planned six months in advance, so that things flow in the way that God has called them to. I think initially there are some visions where God will call you to do something and you have to walk on water, so he doesn't give you the fullness of the vision, or he doesn't give you the fullness of the word, but he's like, this is where I want to start. And then as you journey with him, it kind of unveils itself, and it's like a daily bread kind of thing. It's like a minor thing from heaven, and you're kind of existing in that season of, Lord, what would you have me do today? But I think other times, for like longevity, I like the idea of, okay, God, what do you want me to do for the next month, 3 months, 6 months, and then go from there.
100%. I think that's good. I think kind of based on one of the questions you asked me at the harvest was, I think you have to understand the grace that you have, in the sense that when God has placed something on your heart, he also gives you the grace to do it. And even if it means that there's 2, 3, 4 things going on at the time, if you walk in that grace, it will make it easier for each vision to be executed to its fullest. Because if you don't understand the grace, then you're going to go off the base that, oh, I just feel like I don't have enough time, so therefore maybe you may not execute one vision to its fullest, because you kind of are going off of like human understanding, or like just basically like off of logic basically. But if you go off of just the grace that the Lord is giving you, for example, like how I had to do my exams and the harvest at the same time, like that can only be explained by grace.
Yeah.
And I walked in the fullness of, and maybe I didn't know at the time that the Lord had given me the grace, but I think maybe because he gave me the heart for the harvest.
Mm.
But at the end, I was able to realize that there was a grace that allowed me to do both excellently by the grace of God. Obviously, yeah. I haven't got my results back, but by the grace. That helps me to understand in future projects that I should walk in confidence of the grace that has been given to me.
Yeah.
So that everything that is going on within that season will be executed to its fullest.
That's really beautiful.
Next question. Do you guys think the busy or the busy and booked lifestyle is overhyped and becoming more appealing to our generation?
Oh my gosh, can I speak?
Yeah.
Can I speak?
One thing about me is I'm busy.
Mm-hmm.
One thing about God is he did not call me to be busy. I think that Nana gave me this book because Nana and Vienna are the biggest champions of ET rest. And Nana got me this book, which is called The Redissemination of Harry. And one thing, oh, everyone's nodding, so good. I think one thing that the Lord, sorry, one thing that the Lord actually desires is not for you to be busy. I think when you walk at the pace of love and you walk in pace with the Father, you would find that times and seasons align. You would find that you are working within your capacity. You would find that there is, when you organize, because God likes things done decently and in order. So you would find that you're not called to be like,
literally,
that's not the vision.
Like,
it's not cool.
It's not
I don't think anybody here thought, yeah, this is attractive. Like, we just got here because we didn't take manual, we didn't take blueprint from the Father. Like,
yeah.
I think when you allow God to organize your time and you allow him to tell you, my daughter, this is the strategy, this is the blueprint, this is how I would have you do everything. Because if he's given it to you, then he's given it to you because he knows that he's giving you the capacity for it.
Yeah, yeah.
And one of my favorite verses is Hebrews 4 verse 10, where it talks about God's daily renewal of the promise to invite us to operate from a place of rest because he rested on the sixth day.
Mm-hmm.
And genuinely operate from a place of rest.
Yeah.
Being booked and busy, it's not stylish, it's not attractive, it's not kingdom-like, it's just not of heaven.
Yeah.
I cannot express enough, it's not of heaven. Yeah. Like, genuinely walking in pace with the Father. Like, Jesus was never stagnant. He was constantly moving from place to place to place. But he always had time for people.
Yeah.
He always had time. Like, he always had time. Yeah. And one thing Josiah says to me is, like, I always have time.
Mm.
Like, Josiah is an organizer. Yeah. And he always says to me, like, I always have time. Like, my time is organized. I always have time.
Yeah.
I have things to do, but I always have time.
So, yeah.
And it's like, if God holds times and seasons in his hands, why on earth are we booked and busy? Like, what is that about? But I'm really passionate about that topic because, hey, I'm still learning how to rest, by the way. I actually don't know how to do that, but I'm just very passionate about that topic.
It's good.
But yeah.
Good. I think it also stems down to identity. And I think some people seek identity in being busy because it makes them feel valued.
Good.
But I think when you understand...
Hey! I think when you understand... who you are
deep.
Yeah.
You won't have to, you don't feel the need to prove yourself through doing projects and tasks.
Fantastic.
And rather everything just flows from you. So you can have a 6 month period where you're not doing anything and people are maybe asking you, oh, like, what happened to your page or what happened to this and that? And you're like, no, I'm just resting in the Lord. And you don't feel the need to, oh, I need to come up with the next thing because the other thing was hot. I think that's when you make an idol of a project or you're trying to get, I guess, form of a sense of identity through it.
So
I think, yes, knowing the Lord, knowing whose you are, means that you do things in time and in season, as Mercy spoke about. And as E.T. spoke about as well. And you're just not trying to prove yourself to people.
That was beautiful.
Or even just pre-work of the very quickly, I won't talk too much.
You know what you're allowed to, because that's what the video is about.
No, but
you're
allowed to.
Leave the, for...
What?
I don't know what Anna was saying about it. Don't be scared. Do not fear.
Do you think the multiple projects that you do will eventually align into one overarching career role or industry, or do you see yourself always doing multiple different things?
It depends on the Lord. I think it's possible, definitely, because take Warwick Worship Nights for example. ET actually didn't tell you guys that she founded Warwick Worship Nights. Where it started and where it is now in terms of like recording, I think I was talking to Rachel about it this morning, is completely different. And so I think some some skills that you learn from certain projects will be used in an ultimate project. Mm. So you can be doing a project and God says, okay, I want you to do this for 2 years. You completely close that down, but it's equipped you to do the next thing,
yeah.
which will create like an overarching project. Mm-hmm. But I think there's something so cool about having your hand in this and being on this board of and trustees and doing this and doing that, and then having that be like the theme of your life, just multiple mm-hmm. projects. Yeah. Just do it in all of them very well.
One phrase I just heard when Aanu was speaking was that as a Christian, you're not called to have a career, you're called to serve. And I think you could do that in several different ways. But something mm-hmm. society tries to tell us sometimes is that you have to be almost boxed into one area. So to answer your question, I'm answering for myself. Do I think that I'd like, they don't form into one career? No. But I do think that the skills, kind of as Aanu said, would overlap, but the ultimate goal would be to serve. And I guess having that why for yourself, why you do just everything in life, and bringing that into your different ventures is just such a beautiful thing to see. And one person might know you for one thing, another person might know you for something else, but ultimately it's not about the thing, it's about your heart. Mm-hmm. And your heart shouldn't change whatever sphere you enter into. Yeah. So it's like carrying the heart of God into any and every room, really.
I know for myself that I will have my hands in many different things in my future. That's something that I know for a fact.
Yeah.
The things that God is building at the moment are things that will stand the test of time, and things that haven't been built yet, we're still gonna come. So I don't think I'll ever be someone that's doing just one thing.
Yeah.
I don't think that is, from my conversations with God, that's not his plan.
Yeah.
He might change, but from what I know so far, that's not his plan.
Very similarly. Mine's kind of the same. Like, I remember from secondary school, everyone used to be like, what do you want to be? And I was like, I just feel like God is telling me that I have multiple different projects kind of to steward at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
So that's always been something that he's spoken from way before I kind of even caught up to what he was doing.
Mm-hmm.
So I think even in that, he would have me spending a bit longer building some things. So that, for example, I'd say right now my main sole focus is ATC, but I know that he has asked so much more of me. But again, as Ita was saying earlier, it's just about understanding what the time to release certain things. But yeah, for myself, I know that it's definitely going to look like multiple different projects at once. But then that could also look like a project in itself could be a career that God would kind of take me down. So I'm open to whatever the Lord says.
I think similarly to Mercy, when you said that thing about like what you would say when people would ask you what you wanted to be, my mum used to ask me, we're like friends, and I just used to say, I want to help people.
Yeah.
I said that for maybe 16 years, I just want to help people.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like doctor, lawyer, even though those things are great. And I think that kind of is shown through whatever project God will call me to do.
Yeah.
And so like, even with makeup artistry, it's to help others and to educate. So how can I do that to the best of my capacity in that time? In politics, I study politics, so it's to help people and educate. So how can I serve through policy? How can I do different things? Like, it's, there's an overarching theme, and then everything else just flows from that.
I think for me, it is mainly revolving around the fashion industry. I think ultimately, unless the Lord says otherwise, the goal is to focus on the fashion brand in the future.
Mm.
But it doesn't mean that there's not going to be external projects that will be going around. I think it just means that there's seasons where you focus on things more than other things.
Yeah.
So I feel like I'm in a season where maybe I'm focusing more so on content creation now that I'm finishing university, but I don't see myself doing content creation for the rest of my life, although I will be creating content because I would always desire to be a social media figure or somebody that just has that presence online. But then again, as I've even now begun to like bring my presence online, offline, and trying to like build a community offline as well, that's also something that will be part of something that I do as well. So even as I was speaking at the beginning about how community being such an overarching theme for me, it's going to play into like fashion, my fashion brand, whether it be having like community events to do with like my brand or whatever. But I think just from that perspective of my career, it will more so adhere to the fashion industry, but then again, it could change.
Yeah. That's
beautiful.
Final question. What advice would you give to someone who feels they are called to serve in multiple capacities but fear their degree or job role will suffer?
I think it's understanding grace in part.
Yeah.
Because if you feel called to your degree and you feel just as called to do a project, God has empowered you to do those things.
Mm-hmm.
And Toyosi says something very powerful earlier about It's not about the vision itself, but the person who gives the vision, that's who our trust is in. Mm-hmm. And so we don't trust in chariots and horses and the fact that there is like manpower behind this, or there's there's a strength that may be displayed. We trust in the one who gave the word and who is Jesus Christ. And so if your trust is in Jesus Christ, you won't fear the project. But if your trust is in the project, that can fail.
Yeah.
And so it's just understanding and having that balance on who you put your trust in.
I went on holiday recently.
Paris again.
Thank you, Mercy. I'm glowing, I know. I was talking to a few of my friends on the bus and we were coming back from somewhere. We were just talking about like a lot of our secondary school friends just doing, everyone's doing different things right now. And like, oh, it's best I got this new job, that's great, they're doing this. And then there's something that God just like said to me in that moment that, and one of my mum's biggest prayers actually for her children is like, not that you have the most money, you married the best man, whatever, it's like, find God. And I really, really pray that you find God, because then you realize that, I think a lot of times, and a lot of people our age, it's like, okay, I just need to secure this grad job, I just need to secure this, okay, and then they give me a contract for like however long, but it's like, anything that you start now can fall through. Like, every single thing that happens in the natural, there's a possibility that it won't necessarily work out, but God will always work out. Mm-hmm. And it's like not trusting in the career or the job or the project, but trusting in God, kind of like what Aanu said. And I think a word of encouragement I would give is that you're not just called to one place, and like whatever it is, that don't almost stifle the vision that God has given you to fit a mold that you've seen other people around you mm-hmm. do. And it's funny because recently, like, one of my fears was like, oh God, like, I'm going into finance, you know, have these, this plans, this internship, this job, how am I going to do these other things that I want to do? And kind of like Mercy and you said, like, grace, he's given you the grace to do it. So realizing your inheritance as a child of God. Like, one of my friends said to me recently, like, Toyosi, you always expect people to help you. And it's like, yeah, I expect favor wherever I go to. Not because I'm cocky, but because I know that God is entering the room with me. So I will experience favor. And it's like, whatever you put your hand to, don't let it just be your hand. Know that God is backing your hand and is pushing it forward. Mm-hmm. So God will enable you to do what you need to do, but understanding the times and seasons to do those things and understanding who you need to get involved and when is the right time to get them involved.
It's been a great episode, guys.
Yeah.
That's it, man.
Like, comment, comment, subscribe to all of the things. Thank you guys for watching this episode.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
Wow.
Thank you.
Wow.
So amazing.
Woo!
Everybody say three boza for Angie. One, two, three, boza. One, two, three, boza. So, one, two, three, last boza.
Oh my God.
Get out. Episode. Goodbye.
We will see you. We will serve you.
You're worse.
No, you have to
tell us.
There's no
revenge.
Everybody, there's.